April 11, Palm Sunday. At the U.S. Weather Bureau in Indianapolis, radar observers were keeping anxious watch on storm cells bearing down on the central Midwest. During the preceding hours, a warm, moist front had been rolling northeastward from the Gulf states. Its path would soon collide with a fast-moving cold front coming from the west. Nature, gathering its forces for still another unending assault on man and man-made things. Thunderstorms began to form along the colliding boundaries of the two gigantic air masses. These conditions were being watched closely by the Weather Bureau's Severe Storm Forecasting Center at Kansas City, where a 24-hour watch is kept for weather conditions that might produce violent storms, particularly storms that might spawn tornadoes. When Kansas City obtains data on local storm development, they issue severe weather forecasts for areas covering 20 to 30,000 square miles. Local Weather Bureau offices, using this information, issue local forecasts and outline the counties that might be affected in their areas. Severe weather warnings are issued when the radar shows a typical tornado-type echo or when a funnel is actually observed and reported to the Weather Bureau. On this fateful Palm Sunday, the center at Kansas City issued a severe storm forecast for the area from northeastern Missouri to northern Indiana. At noon, a second forecast was issued for the area from northern Arkansas to southwestern Indiana. The Weather Bureau at Indianapolis plotted the general information being received from Kansas City and prepared reports that outlined the Indiana counties that might be affected. These first reports were meant to reach citizens in the west central and northern portions of the state. The tension, as the weathermen watched, plotted, and reported the threatening weather, was in marked contrast to what was taking place outside. It was a balmy, humid Sunday afternoon. The first really warm day of spring, and Hoosiers, like all other Midwesterners, were outside, stretching, relaxing, taking a Sunday ride. It was the lull before the storm, and the storms came. At 6:35 p.m., the first reports reached the weather bureaus from the Indiana State Police. Tornadoes were ripping across northern Indiana. It was the beginning of a nightmare that Indiana would never forget. Immediately after the twisters had passed, leaving behind their trail of death and destruction, state troopers, local police and civil defense units, firemen and volunteer workers swarmed over the wreckage of what were once homes, apartments, trailer parks, shops and stores, searching for the dead and injured. Every available type of motor vehicle was pressed into ambulance service. Temporary morgues were set up in several locations, even in school gymnasiums. Soon after the dead and injured were removed, state police established a central command center at general headquarters in Indianapolis. 24 hours a day for the duration of the emergency, troopers compile growing casualty lists. The center located and supplied emergency equipment and other items needed in the disaster zones. Thousands of calls poured in night and day from around the world. People everywhere were concerned. More and more information was wanted. Relatives seeking word about the fate of loved ones. Temporary command posts were also set up throughout the stricken areas. Troopers and National Guardsmen established radio communications with the outside and provided local authorities with whatever services were needed. Food, clothing, manpower for cleanup duties, additional police and soldiers to bolster round-the-clock patrols of towns and villages hit by the tornadoes. In the face of Indiana's worst disaster, the governor orders mobilization of every state agency able to supply aid and comfort to the storm victims. In the hours, days, and weeks ahead, state police help coordinate the efforts of the National Guard, State Highway, Department of Correction, Board of Health, and State Board of Public Instruction. Joining the group in working out plans was the Red Cross and Salvation Army. Representatives of all these agencies meet regularly to map out plans of how best they can pool their efforts. During the pre-dawn hours, National Guard and State Police pilots ready themselves and their aircraft for a flyover of the tornado paths at the first light of day. Perhaps in the remote farming regions, there are still victims awaiting aid, cut off from help by blocked roads and downed telephone lines. Tornado is nature's most violent storm. Its destructive forces are unequaled. Weather scientists can only guess at the wind velocities that are generated. 500, maybe 600 miles per hour, some say even higher. No way has yet been found to measure it. Enough screaming, vacuous wind to level brick buildings. Steel towers supporting cross-country high-tension lines are reduced to scrap. Rigid, reinforced utility substations completely destroyed in explosive blasts of wind and unleashed electrical power. How many tornadoes were there? Perhaps 20. Perhaps many more than that. Several of the funnels were so wide, more than a mile at the base, that they spawned smaller twisters that leaped out onto destructive paths of their own. The Palm Sunday twisters that struck Indiana were of virtually unparalleled force. In the wake of the destruction, it was difficult to understand why the death toll was not higher. How so many were able to escape death and serious injury remains a puzzle. The eyewitness accounts of freak and nightmarish events are truths that are truly stranger than fiction. Tales from motorists caught up in the funnels who looked out to find themselves flying through the air, looking down at the ground far below, and then set back down to earth, suffering little or no injury at all. A woman tells of crouching in a ditch and watching above as houses, barns, vehicles, and even human beings pass overhead. The small personal treasures of a family, picture albums, documents, mementos, borne by the tornadic winds to be found hundreds of miles away. This motorist was killed when her automobile was lifted by the tornado and slammed down into the basement of where a house had stood only seconds before. In the midst of still stunning disbelief, the living grope through somber funeral rites. A scene repeated over and over again in the days that followed. A scene that was, in many places, unbelievable. Where toppled tombstones mark the course of the storm, and debris litters the cemeteries. The Palm Sunday twisters ripped three general paths across northern and central Indiana. Each of the three series of tornadoes began their destructive rampages approximately 1 hour apart. Shortly before 6 p.m. in the northern part of the state, towering thunderheads lowered their deadly funnels onto the ground in southern LaPorte County. Heading on a northeasterly course, the twisters smashed into the communities of Coons Lake, La Paz, Lakeville, Wyatt, Dunlap, Shipshawana, and then crossed the state line into Michigan. About 7 o'clock, some 90 miles south of the first line, tornadoes dipped down and blasted their way eastward across the central part of the state, striking first at Odell, then Mulberry, Moran, Middlefort, Rushaville, Alto, Kokomo, Greentown, Swayze, Marion, Dundee, Lynn Grove, Bern, and then crossed into Ohio. Third and last line of tornadoes originated little more than 20 miles southeast of Odell, striking first near Mace, then smashing an eastbound path through Shenandoah, Dover, north of Lebanon, Sheridan, and Arcadia. Then the funnels lifted. In the span of little more than 3 hours, Hoosiers in 17 counties and in scores of cities, towns, villages, and farms had seen the raging blackness bearing down on them, heard the deafening roar, and felt the agonizing pain and helplessness as their homes exploded into worthless debris around them. The sound, the fury, and the death was upon them. When it was over, 139 of them lay dead. More than 1,000 were injured. Nearly 2,000 motor vehicles totally destroyed. The other property damage was too unbelievable to comprehend. The loss would run into the millions of dollars. Never before had so many persons lost their life in any kind of tragedy in Indiana. Never before had there been so many tornadoes in a single day. Never before such widespread destruction. While the scars of the storms are still fresh on the land, the president comes to see for himself what damage has been done, to console the victims and to offer whatever services of the federal government are needed. He is met and welcomed by the governor. Along on the inspection tour are Indiana's United States senators. Even the president, who has been witness to the aftermath of many natural and man-made disasters, is unprepared for what he sees. Later, after the president leaves, rescue workers discover the body of a young victim beneath the rubble, where only hours before the chief executive had passed close by. The president's words, spoken at the site of total destruction, are still remembered. Horrible, horrible. Rushaville. The death and injury toll was far worse in other places around the state, but here there was a special kind of tragedy. Here, nature tried to kill a town. The devastating twisters touched every part of the community. The business district, The familiar small town shops and stores, even the fire department, destroyed. Every home, every building hit. Most destroyed. Many smashed beyond repair. Only a handful of houses escaped with minor damages. The trees that shaded the quiet homes and sidewalks for generation upon generation stripped and uprooted. The State Department of Correction brings inmates from the state prisons to help clean up the debris. The prisoners, sympathetic to the plight of the tornado victims, work hard to do the most they can, and their help is deeply appreciated by the townspeople. Coatesville, a similar-sized community in west-central Indiana, was destroyed by a Good Friday tornado in 1948 and was rebuilt. The citizens of Rushville now face the same long, hard job of rebuilding. Many will succeed, but for some others, it is too late. Out of the confusion and uncertainty that marked the afternoon of Palm Sunday, none perhaps was more pronounced than that of the several different weather bureaus attempting to alert Hoosiers to the storm conditions. The Weather Bureau has, for a long time, used the two terms, forecast and warning. On that day, few, if any, people knew the meaning or the difference between the two terms. In the planning that is now going on to avoid death and injury in tornadoes yet to be born, the two terms will still be used. It is vitally important that everyone now know what they mean exactly. Forecast is a term that is applied when weather conditions are such that severe storms are predicted with the possibility of tornadoes. The term warning is applied when a tornado has actually been seen and reported. On the morning of Easter Sunday, the teardown, the cleanup, the rebuilding stops. The faithful look for special aid and comfort that can only be found through prayers. Their churches have been battered by the storm. Some have been destroyed. Several different faiths share the churches that were spared. The worshipers pause. Some to give thanks that they and their loved ones were spared, and some to ponder their grief. Although sightseers were discouraged, the lure of seeing firsthand one of the Midwest's worst disasters proved too strong to resist. Main highways were jammed with long lines of traffic, but the delays proved only temporary, and to the everlasting credit of those who came to look, they left behind thousands of dollars in donations, money that would be used to help replace a variety of human needs, from fire trucks to window panes. The Hoosier State is world-renowned for its hospitality, and Hoosier citizens for their courtesy and friendly welcome to friends and strangers alike. The misery brought by the storms is virtually engulfed by the aid from citizen to citizen. Homes are open to the homeless and food given to the hungry. It becomes a powerful demonstration that in time of need, Hoosiers take care of their own. The marshaling music of a people struck by disaster is not a trumpet or a drum. It's the roar of a bulldozer, the hum of a chainsaw, and the beat of a hammer. Neighbor helps neighbor to rebuild. The workers swarm over the houses to get repairs made as quickly as possible. Tremendous effort was extended by all of Indiana's power and communications industries. Armies of electric, gas, water, and telephone workmen and women descended on the disaster areas and pitched into a successful round-the-clock battle to restore vital public services. In the aftermath of the disaster, Hoosier citizens began asking of themselves and of each other, what happened and why did it happen here? A searching examination of the known and the unknown began, and it's still going on. Killer tornadoes have struck Indiana before. But time is a healer of unpleasant memories. And in some cases, the memories were secondhand, separated by generations. It had been 17 years since 20 persons were killed by twisters that struck west-central Indiana. True, there had been other tornadoes since then, but the death toll had been slight in comparison, and the destruction confined to smaller areas. How many remembered? Was there enough warning given? Will it, in fact, ever be possible to give enough warning? Weather experts point out that a high percentage of tornadoes that occur cannot even be detected before they are spawned. Who then will be responsible for alerting every man, woman, and child that they may stand in the path of death and destruction from out of the skies? These are the questions that are being asked, and Hoosier citizens are trying to find answers. Indiana has painfully discovered that it is indeed a part of the Middle West's infamous Tornado Alley. All over the state, in communities both large and small, responsible citizens are meeting, working, and planning together to devise more adequate tornado warning systems and to update and improve present reporting procedures. Instrumental in this planning is the Indiana Broadcasters Association, the men and women representing the state's radio and television industry. It is this media for which most people will look to and listen for storm information that will save their lives. During the tornado disaster of Palm Sunday, countless numbers of people were able to protect themselves after being warned by radio and television bulletins that the twisters were approaching. Other agencies working to devise a uniform disaster warning program includes officials of the U.S. Weather Bureau, Civil Defense Corps, and state, county, and local police departments. Knowing what to do when a tornado is approaching may mean the difference between life or death. If time permits, go to a tornado cellar if one is available. If you're in open country, move at right angles to the tornado's path. Tornadoes usually move about 25 to 40 miles per hour. If there is no time to escape, lie flat in the nearest depression, such as a ditch or a ravine. In a city or town, seek inside shelter in a strongly reinforced building. Stay away from windows. In homes, the corner of the basement toward the tornado usually offers greatest safety. In houses without basements, take cover under heavy furniture, against inside walls. Doors and windows on the sides of the houses away from the tornado may be open to help reduce damage to the building. In schools, stay away from windows and stay out of auditoriums and gymnasiums with large roofs. In factories, when a warning has been sounded, a lookout should be posted to keep everyone advised of the tornado's approach. Plans should be made to move workers to sections of the plant offering the most protection. Keep calm. People have been killed by running outside into the storm. Keep tuned to radio or television. You will be advised of the latest information. And don't call the Weather Bureau except to report sighting a tornado. Your call will tie up lines needed to receive vital information about the tornado's progress. The memory of what has happened, as unpleasant as it may be, must serve as a reminder for the future. Beginning at the top, on the level of federal government, the U.S. Weather Bureau is working hard to improve the science of weather forecasting. Constant research is underway. More needs to be done, and is being done, to improve reporting methods and to install the most modern radar and other weather equipment to track killer storms. But the responsibility goes right down the line. Indiana's cities, towns, and villages need to work out tornado warning programs on a community level. Towards this end, the governor has pledged the cooperation and assistance of state government. State police, civil defense, National Guard, and state highway facilities are in or near every Hoosier community and able to offer emergency communications, shelter, and other vital services. The brunt of the responsibility falls on the individual citizen. How many persons heard the tornado warnings and failed to protect themselves and were then killed? No one will ever know for sure. Some, it is known, gave their lives trying to warn others. Farmers and other persons living in the countryside obviously cannot benefit from any group warning plan. They must rely on television and radio reports and be their own lookout for approaching tornadoes. In the tornado disaster zones, evidence still remains of the violence and horror that took place that afternoon. The scars will be there for a long time. The memories will remain even longer. And the tornadoes will come again. For man, since time began, has been at the mercy of the elements. Unable to control it, he must protect himself from it. This was Palm Sunday, Indiana, 1965.